Good evening. I have a friend who's the godfather of my oldest son and also one of America's great chefs. His culinary awakening took place during a year spent in Spain and North Africa in his 20s. He came back with a head full of flavors and opened his first restaurant. More recently, casting about for something to serve to other friends at a dinner, I pulled down one of his cookbooks. I found a recipe that called for the following: red and yellow bell peppers, fennel, raisins, walnut oil, sablefish, orange juice, and polenta. It shouldn't have worked. When my wife saw the ingredients laid out on the counter and got that quizzical look on her face, I had to shoo her away. But I knew enough to trust my friend and to submit to his wisdom. And the resulting meal was one of the best ever to come out of my kitchen. The fiction of Javier Marías is of this kind of mastery. I'm often urging his books on people, and when asked to describe them, I fall back on catalogs of elements that seem, on their own, incongruous. The books are like thrillers, I'll say, except most of the action takes place inside the mind. They're like philosophical novels, except they're deeply suspicious of the idea that we can ever know anything at all. In one sense, they're among the most serious books being published today. They speak with the intensity of the past, as Wendy Lesser has put it. Except that Marías is also among the most playful of novelists, with supporting characters of almost penchantian vividness. He is emotional and cerebral, improvisatory, yet impeccably controlled. His digressions are a signature, yet the signature is never done the same way twice, and rarely does the digression actually turn out to digress. On one page, we might get a murder. On the next, an essay on mortality. And on a third, a photograph of Jane Mansfield. But where a lesser artist, or really, any other artist, might never think to put these things together, Marías intuits connections. To shift metaphorical fields, he's a detective who sees a potential clue in every gesture, every stray word, every surge of passion, every drop of blood. And what holds all this together is the extraordinary daring of his language. For even in Margaret Jewel Costa's translations from the Spanish, it is clear that Javier Marías is one of the great stylists of our time. This has not gone overlooked by readers, critics, or prize committees. Marías's dozen works of fiction to date, including A Heart So White, The Infatuations, and the trilogy Your Face Tomorrow, have garnered twice that many awards, including the Premio Romulo Gallego, the Prix Femina Etrangere, and the International Impact Dublin Award. Translated into 43 languages, they have sold millions of copies worldwide. In his latest novel, Thus Bad Begins, a man recalls his entanglement with a film director, his wife, and their friends and enemies and frenemies in the remarkable period just after the end of Franco's dictatorship in Spain. But of course, this being a Marías novel, little is as it seems. Looking back now from 30 years on, our hero, Juan de Vere, remembers how, quote, "We strive to conquer things, never thinking in our eagerness that they will never definitely be ours, that they rarely last and are always susceptible to loss. Nothing is ever forever. We often fight battles or hatch plots or tell lies, commit vile deeds or acts of treachery or foment crimes, always forgetting that the thing we obtain might not last, and that once their effect fades or expires, all the battles and plots, the lies and vile deeds, the betrayals and crimes will seem utterly futile to us, or worse, superfluous. We see no further than tomorrow and see it as the end of time." Style at this level is not just a way of with words. but a way of illuminating the world. And Marías, like Stevens or Faulkner or Conrad or Stern before him, is one of those writers who manages, through the prism of his sensibility, to reveal a singular whole out of what we'd previously thought of as separate phenomena. Before him, this fusion had seemed impossible. Now it seems inevitable and exhaustible each time we encounter it anew. Ladies and gentlemen, in France, he is a Chevalier of the Order of Arts and Letters. In Spain, a member of the Real Academia. He's a weekly columnist for El País, a partisan of Real Madrid, and not least, the King of Redonda. Please join me in welcoming Javier Marías.
Good evening. Thank you very much for being here, and thank you very much to Garth, Risk, Hallberg for this very generous introduction. I shall read a couple of passages. The first one is the opening pages of this latest novel of mine in English, Thus Bad Begins. This story didn't happen so very long ago, less time than the average life, and how brief a life is once it's over and can be summed up in a few sentences, leaving only ashes in the memory, ashes that crumble at the slightest touch and fly up with the slightest gust of wind. And yet, what happened then would be impossible now. I mean, above all, what happened to them? To Eduardo Muriel and his wife, Beatriz Noguera, when they were very young. Rather than what happened to me and them when I was a young man and their marriage was a long, indissoluble misery. That's a difficult word to say in English. The latter would, of course, still be perfectly possible, what happened to me. I mean, given that it's happening to me now, or perhaps it's still part of the same ongoing story. And I suppose what happened with Van Vechten and so on could also occur. There must always have been Van Vechtens, and they won't suddenly stop existing. They will always be there in real life and in its twin fiction, because the nature of the characters never changes, or so it seems. They continue to be repeated over the centuries as if the two spheres lacked imagination or had no alternative. After all, both spheres are the work of the living. Perhaps the dead are more inventive. Sometimes it's as if, like very young children, we can only really enjoy one drama or one story, albeit with infinite variations that disguise both drama and story as either ancient or modern, but always essentially the same. Therefore, throughout the ages, there must also always have been Eduardo Muriel's and Beatriz Noguera's, and the same applies to the bit part players, too. There have been endless Juan de Veres, because that was and is my name, Juan Vere, or Juan de Vere, depending on who is saying or thinking my name. There's nothing original about me. Divorce did not exist then, nor was there much hope of it ever existing when Muriel and his wife married some 20 years before I became involved in their lives, or rather, before they entered mine, the life, if you like, of a mere beginner. But right from the very moment we come into the world, things begin to happen to us. Its weak wheel takes us skeptically and duly, and reluctantly drags us along because it's an old wheel and has unhurriedly ground down many lives by the light of its idle sentinel, the cold moon, which dozes and observes with just one eye open, and knows all the stories even before they happen. Someone only has to notice you or cast an indolent glance in your direction, and there's no withdrawing. even if you hide away or say very still, or stay very still and quiet and take no initiative or do anything. Even if you try to erase yourself, you have been spotted, like a distant shape on the ocean that you can't ignore, that you must either avoid or approach. You count for other people and they count on you until you disappear. Although in the end, that wasn't true to me, of me either. I wasn't totally passive, nor did I pretend to be a mirage, to make myself invisible. I've always wondered how people dare to contract marriage, and did so for centuries when marriage was for life, especially women, for whom it was harder to find an escape route. Or if they did, they had to be doubly or triply careful to conceal such escapades, and five times more careful if they returned carrying cargo and had to disguise a new being before it even had a face to show to the world. From the moment of its conception or detection or presentiment, not to say its annunciation, and to make it an impostor for the rest of its existence, often leaving that new being perennially unaware of its own imposture or its bastard origins, not even when he or she was old on the verge of never again being detected by anyone. Innumerable children have believed someone to be their father who was not, and believed half-siblings to be their true brothers or sisters. And they have gone to the grave with that belief and that error intact. Or perhaps one should say the deceit to which their stoical mothers had submitted them from birth. Diseases or deaths are the other two main things one can contract. All three share the same verb, as if all of them augured ill or presaged doom, or were at the very least painful. But unlike them, there was definitely no cure, no remedy for marriage, no resolution, or only through the death of one of the spouses, a death sometimes silently longed for, and less often sought or induced or prompted, usually even more silently or in deepest secrecy. Or the death of both, of course. And then there would be nothing more, only the unwitting children they'd had, if any, and if they had survived, and a brief memory. Or on occasions, a story. A tenuous, rarely told story, since people tend not to tell stories about their personal life. Mothers who remain stoical until the last breath, and many non-mothers too. Or if they do tell their story, they tell it only in whispers, so that it isn't as if they had never existed, so that they do not remain with a grieving face pressed into the silent pillow, or visible only to the somnolent half-open eye of the cold sentinel moon. The second passage is a description of the main character together with the narrator, of course, a film director. Eduardo Muriel had a thin mustache, as if he had first grown it when the actor Errol Flynn was still around and had then forgotten to change it or allow it to grow more thickly. One of those men of fixed habits as regards his appearance, the kind who doesn't notice that time passes and fashions change, not that he himself is growing and change, nor that he himself is growing older. It's as if time did not concern him, and so could be discounted, rendering him immune to its passing. And up to a point, he was right not to worry about it or to pay it any attention. By attaching no importance to his age, he kept it at bay. By not giving in to it in external matters, he rejected it. And so the timid passing years, which make bold with almost everyone else, prowled and stalked, but didn't dare to claim him, did not take root in his mind or affect his appearance, merely casting upon it a very slow shower of sleet or shadow. He was tall, well above average height for a man of his generation, the generation just after my father's, or possibly the same one. At first glance, his height made him seem strong and slim, although he didn't exactly conform to the mainly stereotype. He had rather narrow shoulders, which made his belly seem larger, even though he carried no excess fat there or on his hips, from which emerged a pair of very long legs that he didn't know quite what to do with when he sat down. If he crossed them, and that, generally speaking, was his preferred position, the foot of the upper leg easily touched the floor, a pose also achieved, albeit by artificial means and with the aid of foreshortening and high heels, by certain women who are particularly proud of their calves and who prefer not to leave one leg dangling free or to become pushed out of shape by the supporting knee. Because of his narrow shoulders, Muriel used to wear jackets with carefully disguised shoulder pads, I think. Or perhaps his tailor cut them in the form of an inverted trapezium. In the 1970s and 1980s, he still went to see his tailor, or his tailor came to him, which was unusual even then. He had a very straight nose, with not a trace of a curve despite its good size, and its thick, predominantly dark brown hair, parted with a wet comb, as doubtless his mother had done ever since he was a child, a tradition he had seen no reason to break with, had a sprinkling of gray. His thin mustache did little to diminish his bright, spontaneous, youthful smile. He tried to restrain that smile or repress it, but often failed, because there was in him an underlying spirit of joviality, or a past self that emerged easily and without the need to send a sounding line down very deep. Nor, on the other hand, was it to be found in very shallow waters, for in those there floated a certain bitterness, either habitual or unconscious, of which he felt he was not the cause, but possibly the victim. The most striking thing about him, though, when one saw him for the first time or came across a rare full-face photo in the newspaper, was the patch he wore over his right eye, a classic theatrical or even filmic eye patch, black and bulky and held in place by a thin black piece of elastic. I have always wondered why such eye patches have a rough surface. I don't mean the cloth ones intended only as temporary protection, but the permanent fitted ones made of some stiff, compact material. It looked like bakelite, and I often felt tempted to drum on it with my fingernails to find out how it felt. Not that I ever tried his with my employer. I did, however, find out what it sounded like, because sometimes when he was upset or irritated, but also whenever he paused to think before uttering a sentence or embarking on a speech, with his thumb tucked under one armpit as if it were the tiny riding whip of a soldier or a cavalryman reviewing his troops or his mounts, Muriel did exactly that, drumming on his eye patch with the fingernails of his free hand, as if summoning the aid of his non-existent or useless eye. He must have liked the sound it made, and it was rather pleasing, tock, 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 although until one got used to the gesture it did, to the gesture, it did make one cringe slightly to see him invoking his absent eye. Perhaps the somewhat bulky shape of the patch is intended to give the impression that there is an actual eye underneath, when there might be only be an empty socket, a hollow, a dent, a depression. Perhaps those patches are convex precisely in order to contradict the awful concavity that in some cases they conceal. Who knows? Perhaps the cavity is filled by a polished sphere of white glass or marble with the pupil and the iris painted on with pointless perfect realism. An eye that will never be seen, always covered in black or seen only by its owner at the end of the day, when standing before the mirror, he wearily uncovers or perhaps removes it. And while the patch inevitably drew one's attention, his useful visible eye, the left one, was no less striking, being of an intense dark blue, like the sea at evening or perhaps at night, and which, because it was alone, seemed to notice and register. Thank you. Absolutely everything, as if it possessed both its own faculties and those of the other invisible blind eye, or as though nature had wanted to compensate for the loss of its pair by making it more than usually penetrating. Such was the energy and speed of the left eye that I would gradually and furtively try to place myself out of its reach so as not to be wounded by its piercing gaze until Muriel would tell me off. A little to the right, I can barely see you there unless I lean sideways. Don't forget my field of vision is more limited than yours. And at first, when I didn't know where to look, torn between that living maritime eye and the dead magnetic patch, he would have no hesitation in calling me to order. Juan, I'm talking to you with the seeing eye, not the dead one. So please listen and don't get distracted by the eye that isn't saying a word. Muriel would openly refer to his halved vision, and like those who draw an awkward veil of silence over any personal defect or disability, however conspicuous and dramatic. People who have had one arm amputated at the shoulder, but who never acknowledge the difficulties they face and do just about everything short of taking up juggling. One-legged people who scale an Annapurna on crunches. Blind people who go to the cinema and then make a fuss during the scenes with no dialogue, complaining that the image is out of focus. Disabled people who pretend they're not wheelchair bound and insist on trying to climb stairs rather than using the ramps that are available everywhere nowadays. Men with heads like billiard balls who, whenever there's a gust of wind, are constantly smoothing their non-existent hair and getting frustrated with their imaginary unruly mop. Not that I'm criticizing them in the least, of course. They're free to do exactly as they like. But the first time I asked him what had happened to his eye, how his silent eye had been struck dumb, he replied as brusquely as he did sometimes to people who annoyed him, although he rarely did so with me, for he usually treated me with great kindness and affection. Let's get one thing straight. I don't employ you to ask me questions about matters that are none of your business. That's it. Thank you.
So Javier, thank you for that reading.
And for treating us to...
I don't... I don't think I did read very well because I didn't know exactly. I mean, you have to get a little accustomed to the text, and of course, the text is in English. Therefore, it's not exactly my text. And then I'm sorry, I was rather doubtful at times.
But perhaps appropriate to the equivocations of the narrator. I had thought to begin somewhere else, but given this week's events, the title of your novel has taken on an incredible new resonance. Thus Bad Begins.
Yes, but there's a funny thing with that, by the way, and I think it's important, now that you mention it as a possible description of the present situation, only possible, that title comes as some others in my novels from Shakespeare. It's a not very well-known quotation, even if exactly the previous words to that quotation are so famous that they even belong to the English language, at least in Britain. People say that, and many people say that not even knowing it comes from Shakespeare. The previous words is, I must be cruel to be kind. And then Hamlet adds, thus bad begins and worse remains behind. Now, the funny thing is that my characters, who are Spaniards, understand the second half of the sentence, and worse remains behind us, and worse is left behind. Whereas I've seen that some annotators, some Shakespearean annotators, and also some translators into different languages, there's been a slight problem with translations and that, understand it exactly the opposite way. And worse lurks behind
the bad.
Still to come, awaits behind whatever. The important thing in the novel is the way the characters understand it, which is, thus bad begins and worse is left behind, which I think is more attractive as a as an idea. But it's better that we think that for the present situation, my characters are right, because otherwise, worse would be lurking behind and still to come, and the beginning of the bad would only be the beginning of something worse afterwards. Don't you agree?
Well, in that connection, I wanted to ask you about the smell of fascism. There's a scene in the novel where your protagonist follows
yes.
the director's wife, Beatrice,
mm-hmm.
to this kind of oddly Germanic monastery property.
Sanctuary.
And he thinks—
In the middle of Madrid, yes.
The place had a strong whiff of the far right about it. And the far right at the time was very active, not to say rabid. We all knew the stench well. It was unmistakable and still is now, three decades on, for those of us who had been choked by it. So just a voyage for a second into the political olfactory. What is the smell of fascism and how does it fit into this period of La Movida, which is what you call the period
yeah,
after.
Well, it was called that. Yeah, that period, as far as the arts and literature and all that were concerned. I mean, the period was called rather the transition from dictatorship to democracy, obviously.
And so, during that time, there is still, and you get the sense in the novel, playing into the quotation, I guess, lurking behind. You know, the surface of the transition, there are still these pockets, there are still these characters, these people, these stories. I was just curious, what is the smell of fascism for you personally?
Well,
and how did this period sort of suggest itself?
I don't know, I can smell it in Spain. Because
We need to know how to detect it.
Yeah, but you know, I mean, The novel takes place in 1980. It is not. It's told by a man in in his 50s or around 50, but he recalls what happened in 1980 when he was 23, and he had just finished his university studies and got a job with this Eduardo Muriel, this film director. And 1980 is only 5 years after Franco's death. And it's 1 year previous to the divorce law in Spain. So in 1980, people were waiting for it, among other things, but there was no divorce yet. It came 1 year after that, and which is an important thing for this married couple I have mentioned in my reading. And of course, one of the important things that happened then was what to do with what had happened for 37 years of dictatorship. Many things had happened, and of course there were many people who had done horrible things, and they had been collaborators to Franco, not only his own ministers and the army, et cetera, et cetera, but also writers, authors, painters.
Your father?
No, my father was not a collaborator.
No, but he was on the opposite side, right?
Yeah, he was on the opposite side.
And was not treated well.
He was in prison. In fact, he was in prison in 1939, immediately after the end of the war. He was very lucky because the normal thing for him would have been to be shot. And I wouldn't be here then, by the way. But he was lucky in the end after he spent 3 months in jail or something. But that's something else. Now, there was some kind of agreement in the first years after Franco's death that perhaps nobody should be taken to trial. It was, on the other hand, rather impossible, an impossible thing to do, even if we wanted to, because what young people, for instance, now some younger generations in Spain are saying rather unfair things about that period, about the transition, saying, oh, this is Francoism, the continuity of Francoism and things like that, which is not true. It's simply not true. And there was an amnesty law, which was agreed upon by practically all society. Say, well, let's leave things. That's the only way not to have bloodshed again.
It's really the absence of a truth and reconciliation process. And I read this, Javier Cercas has written this book, Anatomy of a Moment. And
yeah.
And unless I'm misreading him, I think he finds there to be a lot of positive things about, or positive is too strong a word, but to say this was really the only way to move forward.
Yeah, it was probably the only way, and it has to do. I mean, this is not Thus Bad Begins is not at all a political novel. It has a political background, and of course, you could establish very easily a certain parallelism between the private lives of the characters, what happened, which is the main thing. I mean, this is a novel about private lives and private stories, and also what happened collectively to the country. And one of the subjects of the novel, as it is also maybe one of the subjects of other novels by me, is what to do with what we know. Should we always tell it? Should we always act accordingly, according to what we know, or should we leave things? Should we leave things alone sometimes? Should something that we know of go unpunished, or should we always be remembering it? Is it what is more important, to remember everything all the time, or to let a few things go into oblivion in order to go on and to move on, and still more, not to have bloodshed again? For instance, we had a terrible bloodshed in the 1930s during the Civil War. It was terrible on both sides, in fact. The only thing is that the winning side went on doing that, repressing and murdering and shooting people for almost 37 more years. There's a big difference, of course. But during the war, it was everything terrible. And then that's one of the subjects also in the characters' private lives. I don't want to spoil the novel to anyone, of course, but there is a moment in which one of the characters tells you betrayed me twice, more or less, he said. You betrayed me twice. One, by keeping a secret, an important one, from me at a given moment. But the second treason was even worse to me, in a sense, which was that years after that, all of a sudden, you decided not to go on keeping the secret. And you revealed that to me. And that was worse, because it was then, really, when you ruined my life. You ruined my life twice, in a way. I mean, you kept a secret that was important. I wouldn't even have been with you or married to you, let's say that, but to someone else, Anna, if you had been honest at a given moment. But I was not in love with you, but it was easy to love you. And I did. And then for 12 years or so, I did. And we had children, et cetera, et cetera. And I lived in the belief that, I don't want to spoil too much, but in the belief that something had happened, as you told me, it had happened. And all of a sudden, 12 years after that, or I can't remember if it's 12 or 14 years after that, you tell me, no, that was not like it. So and then you've ruined these 14 years, because then what have I lived, really? What's been my life? My life, I can't deny my life. The life I lived during these 12 or 14 years has been one that I cannot erase. That's what I did live. At the same time, now you tell me it was all based on falsehood, on a lie, or something you hid from me. What shall I do now with those 12 years? Must I erase, which is not possible, what I did live? Must I forget that I did live it? And that's one of the things that matter very much for the characters, and also for the title and the quotation from Shakespeare. In a sense, you could say that by being silent, Spanish society accepted that something bad was happening, because people went unpunished or got away with what they had done, many, many people. But worse was left behind, thanks to that. I don't even know what to think myself about all that matter. It's something that really perplexes me on many occasions. I never know exactly what should be done about that. And maybe because I don't know, that's why I write on that subject now and then.
Because novels are the perfect vehicle for perplexity rather than, you know, perplexity, complication, subtlety rather than...
They should be.
Didacticism. So I didn't mean to present it as an allegory, but I think as Javier spoke, you could really hear how this novel, which is very much the story of a marriage, does resonate against the kind of background of the social and political world in which it takes place. I was wondering, I read an interview where you talked about, I'm not sure how facetiously, writing novels almost for the purpose of including a few paragraphs or sometimes only a few sentences mm-hmm. that wouldn't stand up on their own, and which the novel is almost like an arch, you know, to hold up this one capstone. The example you gave in the interview was Tomorrow and the Battle, Think on Me.
That's a very old novel, I mean, so I must have said it about 20 years ago or more.
So I'm wondering if there's similarly a core passage or image or set of paragraphs or sentences in Thus Bad Begins that you felt yourself writing around or toward or that you began with.
Well, if there is, I won't say which one.
20 years from now, you can do an interview and say which
maybe. One. Now, what I meant then, in maybe it's true sometimes, is that I think most novelists, that would be presumptuous on my part, but at least the kind of novelist I am, and maybe others too, know very well that, or think, of course, you're never a good judge of what you do, but they think that Very often there are a few paragraphs or a couple of pages or something that are better than the rest. And in my case, I usually think that, I may be mistaken, of course, I think that of some paragraph which are slightly lyrical, you could say, or they contain a digression or a reflection or a short meditation, maybe it's even half a page or something like that, or sometimes a little more. And you're rather satisfied with that, and you say, this is the gist of the novel. You say that?
I think so. I think we could say that, the gist.
G-I-S-T?
But you really don't want to say what the gist of the novel is.
No, I'm not going to say.
Don't answer this question, because you have to read the whole novel. He's not going to just give you the gist.
No. I mean, but sometimes
the
you
crux.
Think, sometimes you think, this is, I wrote, you realize, I mean, it's not something that you know beforehand, but when the novel is done, when it's more or less finished, sometimes you, well, now I realize, well, at least that's my case, I'm speaking always for myself, obviously. Because of these paragraphs, I wrote this novel. Because of this couple of pages, for instance, I realize that now. And then sometimes you think, well, I'm not a poet, I don't write poetry, never wrote poetry, not even when I was a young man or a teenager. And then you say, well, I had to surround this with something else, with something huge, with an architecture to hold it, to make it acceptable. But what I want is the reader to look mainly at those pages. But I have to distract him or her with stories, plots, dialogues.
All that stuff.
But that is something you realize when you finish the novel. It's not something that you have in your mind previously. Obviously.
I see. So you're speaking of those paragraphs for which you realize in the end, all along I was moving toward this and I didn't.
In a way, yes. But that's something that comes, I mean, it's not a premeditated thing to do. That would be vile, I suppose. And no, it's not that way. But sometimes you say, well, yeah, the justification for this whole thing are these two pages.
That wonderful word in French, I think the raison, you know, has multiple layers of resonance. But you spoke of plot and character and all that stuff, and this is novelist talking. You know, sometimes you think, I got a plot, character. But I wanted to talk a little bit about one of those things, one of those novelistic things that keeps readers reading, which is the degree of, and especially in your novels, the degree of suspense you generate. Often, when I'm reading you, even before I know what the question is, I feel myself waiting to get to the answer. I think of, the Brothers Karamazov. It's like a murder mystery in a way, but the crime is announced, or even invited early on, but you wait half the book for it to happen. Mm-hmm. And I remember reading The Infatuations, the moment where Maria is going to the door to eavesdrop. Mm-hmm. And I was reading as though I were in a movie theater, you know, covering my eyes, saying, don't go to that door. I'm wondering for you whether, how cognizant you are of the pace or the pulse of suspense as you're writing, whether this is just something that comes very naturally to you, or whether it's an kind of an epiphenomenon of your style, or whether you actually do a lot of sort of editing and revising and scheming.
Oh, no, not really. I have my method for writing is a very suicidal one.
All methods for writing are suicidal,
probably,
I think.
Probably, but you feel more suicidal the one you chose, or the one that chose you. Anyway, and what I usually do is, as I've said on many occasions, probably if some people have read interviews, I've been saying that for many years, and it's true. It's still true, even with the more recent novels. One of the problems with novelists is that We never learn the job. We never learn it. I mean, in the sense that other people do. I mean, a professor goes to give his lesson after 40 years, as is my case. I mean, I published my first novel when I was 19, which is over 40 years ago. And, you know, a teacher goes after 40 years teaching, and he knows he will give a good lesson, or at least a decent one by now, and he will do it with ease. And a carpenter who's been making tables or whatever for 40 years, he knows he will succeed with the next table, etc. A novelist doesn't know that at all.
Do you have the moment where you sit down to write the next book and you think you must have learned something last time, and then you
you learn you haven't learned anything. Yeah. And even if the previous book or some of the previous books have been praised by people and people enjoy them and all that, and not even that is reassuring in my case, because I was lucky with that one, or people were misled or something, but that doesn't guarantee anything for this one that I'm starting now. But what I was going to say is that my usual way is, I've said on many occasions that, of course, there are all kinds of writers, but there are some who write with a map, as it were. That is, they know exactly, with a chart.
I hate those people. I don't understand them at all.
No, why should you hate them? I mean, all methods are, depends on the result and those methods. But they know exactly before starting a novel, they have the full story in their minds. They know exactly what's going to happen to every character, when, etc., which is certainly not my case. I think if I knew a complete story before starting writing a novel, I wouldn't write it, because I said, what a bore. I like to find out as I write, and I mentioned on many occasions as well that the word to invent, which is the same in English and in Spanish and in many other languages, inventar in Spanish, to invent in English, comes from Latin invenire. And invenire originally in Latin meant to find out, to discover. And then to a certain extent to invent in our sense, in the sense of the word in English or in Spanish, etymologically, at least, has to do with the idea of finding out, which is what I like to do. I start writing with a compass only. I don't have a map. I just have a compass. So I'm heading north, as it were. I know more or less where I would like to go, but I don't know the way, not at all, and I don't know whether I shall find a desert in the middle, or a cliff, or a river, or a jungle, or what, and I must cross it, and I find them. Whereas the one with the map knows that he will find a jungle and a desert and a cliff, but he knows beforehand, and he knows very well when and how. And then the thing is that I don't know exactly how I do my novels. In fact, I realize every time I don't know how a novel is written. I don't know how people do write them, and in fact, I don't know how I do write them myself. All of a sudden, you happen to have 300 or 400 or 500 even pages and say, oh, this looks like a novel. But I work page by page. I never make a draft of 5 or 10 pages in a row, no. I make one page, I work on that. I still use a typewriter. Then I take out the piece of paper, then I make corrections by hand and erase things and arrows and suppressions and additions and everything. Then I retype it again, once, twice, three times, four times, five times sometimes, until I think, well, I can't do it better than this, or I'm tired, which is also possible. And then that page generally goes to the printer, like that. And then one page after another. And I never reread the whole thing until the novel is finished. Because if I say, oh, come on, I have 200 pages now, shall I reread them and say,
shall I ruin them by reading them?
What if I found them awful? Now the whole thing would be ruined, and I wouldn't have the faith to go on if I find. So I won't read them, and just one by one, as if it was each, as if it was the only one. I mean, I concentrate on that one page. I do it as best as I can, but it has no real relationship to the next one or to the previous one. So to me, it is rather mysterious that in the end, as some readers, very kind readers, have told me, some of them even say, I couldn't put it down, and your novels are so seamless. And I say, oh, dear me. It's exactly the opposite way.
I think the reason I said I hate the map people is I have this idea that the map people aren't suicidal, and that it's the compass people who are going, we have no idea
they are
how
too.
To do this. Okay, well, that's reassuring.
No, they are too, that's because, I mean, there is one thing against them that plays against them, I think, which is because of their knowing exactly what is going to happen throughout the novel and what effect they will need or what suspense they will need at a given moment, they are more foreseeable, they are more predictable. And sometimes they don't realize, because they already know the ending, the reader can guess the ending in a much easier way than in the novels of the writers with only a compass. Because they have improvised, they didn't even know the ending. So it's very difficult that the reader may predict the ending if the writer himself didn't even know it. Maybe 30 pages away from the ending. I remember I wrote a novel in 1986, a short novel. I remember there was 30 pages away from the end, and I didn't even know who was going to die, or if anyone was going to die. And so I had to decide that. Shall I make him die? Now it seems impossible that someone else had died instead of the one who did die in that novel. But of course, a long time has elapsed. And I remember very well, there was a moment it was, well, I can do this, I can do that, I can kill this one, I can. And by the way, if you allow me, I think because we were talking about that, I think that one of the reasons why we still write and read novels and fiction in general is, I wrote a few years ago a speech to be delivered that was titled On the Difficulty of Telling, and which more or less I said, telling is very difficult, and telling actual things is almost impossible. For an historian, for instance, an historian tells facts and as much as he knows about them, but some other historian may come and say, may contradict him or her, and say, no, you're not right. Oh. Say, for instance, we have just discovered a bunch of letters from Napoleon, and that makes the story completely different. Or we've gone to the Soviet archives and found documents that prove that you were wrong, etc. But even when we tell something that we just witnessed, an incident happened this morning on our way to our job, I don't know, in the subway, for instance, and you start telling, oh, I saw this man striking that other man, and you start telling something very simple. And then if someone else was with you and witnessed the scene as well, you say, no, wait a minute, you came late to the scene, because what you didn't see, I see, and I had a better angle. Also for the scene is that the beaten man had provoked the other one by blah, 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 blah. So nothing is very certain. If you come to think of that, or at least that happens in trials in movies or in old movies, there are moments in which telling is so impossible that we've seen that in films. I don't know if that happens in real life in America. But sometimes they ask a witness or they ask someone to do exactly the same movements they saw someone doing, or as if words were not enough. Telling with words is very difficult. Everything can be denied, everything can be contradicted. And I think that one of the reasons why we write and read novels is that, in a way, we need something, even if it's fictional, even if it never did happen, to be told once and for good, once and forever. And the only thing that no one can contradict or deny is fiction. Mm. Someone could come and say, I mean, Madame Bovary died the way she did. And no one can come and say, oh, I disagree. She didn't die, or she stabbed herself.
He faked her death. And
no, or she stabbed herself. No one can do that. So that Madame Bovary did die, died the way Flaubert decided, and that's the end of it. And no one can contradict it. And even if it's fiction, even if she didn't really exist, we need the security, you could say, or the comfort of something told for sure, once and for all. And something not told as well forever, because of course you must have in mind that what is not told in a novel shall never be told by anyone. As in a painting, the same thing. I mean, a painting, you have a painting. I remember there is a scene, I talked about that in a scene in my novel, A Heart So Wide, which is almost 25 years old, in which there is a museum guard at the Prado, whose name was Mateu, I remember, who's been there for years and years and years in a room that has the only Rembrandt we have at the Prado, which is a painting of Sofonisba or some lady from ancient times. And she's a fat lady with a necklace, pearls and all that. And then there is a young servant approaching her, and she's seen from the back. You only see her back. And then this Mateo, this guard, in that scene at a given moment, takes out a lighter out of his pocket and starts burning the frame of the Rembrandt. And then the narrator's father, who works there as a curator or something, startled, and said, well, let's go easy. And he approaches this man and says, Mateo, what are you doing with that lighter? He starts with the frame, you know. And then this guard says, I'm going to burn this. I've been here for 20 years looking at this fat lady all the time. I'm tired of not being able to see the young girl's face. She's always giving me her back, and I'm absolutely tired of that. So I'm going to burn it. I can't stand it anymore, etc., etc. Which is true in a sense, because a painting shows what it shows, and what it doesn't show, it shall never be shown. I mean, the young maid's face shall never be seen because it's not there. In a novel, they seem much more dynamic, things happening and all that. It's almost the same thing. What is told forever. What is not told shall never be. No?
No, this all sounds very, very plausible to me. It's like the only thing that we can believe in is what's completely made up, I suppose.
Yeah. But at least we have a full story, you know.
And your father was a philosopher, is that right?
Yeah.
And
he was Ortega y Gasset's main disciple, yes.
And so I wanted to ask you, you know, the kind of, there's almost a philosophical world in which your fiction takes place. There's preoccupations with eternity and infinity and variation and the impossibility of variation with, you know, what's about to happen, what can never happen, everything has already happened. Mm-hmm. Have you been thinking about these things sort of more or less your whole life, or was there a moment in your writing life where you thought, aha, this should come into my work?
No, I don't think my novels are philosophical at all, precisely because my father was a philosopher. I know that philosophy is a very different thing from what I do, and precisely and there is a huge difference between what I do or a novelist can do and a philosopher does. To begin with, I've called it what I do. I think is a different thing, and I'm not the only one to have done it at all. In the past, many authors did that, which is what you might call, and I've called often, literary thinking or literary thought, which has nothing to do with thinking about literature. That would be boring. It's thinking literarily of things, which is a different way of thinking. I mean, you have all kinds of thinking. You have religious thinking, you have scientific thinking, philosophical thinking, of course, psychoanalytic, whatever, all kinds of thinking. There is a literary way of thinking as well. And it has some advantages in comparison with philosophy, for instance. One of the things that is that what you all of a sudden say in a novel, and sometimes the reader recognizes as something truthful, I've often used the word recognition for novels. I think that at least one of the things that move me most as a reader is when I find a scene or a meditation or an observation in a novel, and I recognize it. Yes, this is true. I have experienced this, but I didn't know that I knew it until I've seen it said by Proust, of course. He's the master of that, or Shakespeare as well. And then you can say things in a very arbitrary way. They are like flashes, whereas a philosopher needs to demonstrate in principle, or at least the old philosophers, need to demonstrate step by step a series of things that a novelist is something a novelist doesn't do. On the contrary, a novelist just throws a true sentence or a true observation, someone that a reader may feel as true, and precisely because he recognizes something that he didn't know he knew, but he recognizes it. And I said, I've experienced that. So I think it's quite a different thing. And I'm to answer your question, it's not something that I all of a sudden decided, this could be useful for my novels. Or no, I don't look for subjects for my novels. I usually write, or at least during the last 30 years, I write novels on the same things that do concern me in my life. And the things that make me think, and some of them are, for instance, secrecy, treason, friendship, betrayal, the impossibility of knowing anything for certain, as I said, the fact that we usually act upon hearsay most of the time. The things we do actually witness are very few, very, very few. To put an example, an easy example, that Trump has been elected president of the United States is hearsay, a rumor. I mean, it's something we've watched on TV or we've read, but have we witnessed it somehow? And of course, everything we usually believe to be true, which is what the press tells us that has actually happened, well, the press says so, but have we seen it? Have we witnessed it? Of course, the press sometimes, or the media sometimes, I mean, mainly they say the truth, of course, the truth, and I wish what I just did say was hearsay was actually hearsay. But personally, I mean, but of course, sometimes they introduce some falsehoods because we normally don't check anything. We can't, in fact. Can we? Can we go to the voting and count the votes ourselves? No, we don't do that, of course. We just trust them. We just believe what we hear, what they say to us. So that's another thing that does worry me. Something else, which I already mentioned, is what to do with memory, what to do with oblivion. It's very easy to forget things. We don't even know what we think we know the facts about the facts, at least the facts about our own lives, but that's not quite true. If you start telling who you are, for instance, well, my name is blah, I was born here in that year, and my father was, and my mother was, and as soon as that, you start thinking, well, wait a minute, my father was, I know who my father was, generally, we know who our father was, and my mother, and how they were, ever since they were our parents, ever since they became our parents. But in fact, we did come late to their lives. We generally don't know much about them before they got married and started being our parents. We usually don't ask ourselves about them until we are 30-something, generally, I would say. That comes really late for most people in life, wondering about who was my father, what kind of man was he before he became my father, what did he want, did he marry my mother, or did my mother marry my father because they were in love, as I always like to believe, or there was no one else to marry them, which is possible, or out of spite, because one of them had just been turned down by the love of his or her life, for instance, and you start thinking, and were they in love with someone else before? What happened? What didn't happen? So you realize you don't know much about them. And then you go on and say, well, I know about myself, you generally know what we did, the positive things. I wrote this book, I went to that school, to that college, etc., etc. All right. I married that person. But we are not only that. We don't consist of that only. We also consist of what we didn't do, what we failed at, what we didn't dare to do, what we discarded at a given moment. We are also the person who didn't marry that girl, or because of whatever she didn't want, or you were afraid, or whatever. All those things not achieved, all those things that you were not bold enough to try, the books you didn't write if you wanted to be a writer, and you know that you didn't, or you were not strong enough to do that. And I say strong because I think that writing novels is a very, very difficult thing, and I'm amazed always that there are hundreds of thousands of people writing novels around the world, because I think it's an extremely difficult task. And some people realize that, and they say, no, I can't do it, besides the talent or no talent, but I don't have the strength to be here writing this one day after another and all that. And all those things are part of us. Nobody knows, but you. But we are made of that as well. So when we start saying, well, yes, I did this, I did that, and that's who I am, it's not completely true. We are also, and then we don't know so much about ourselves either. Not even about, we may know the facts of our life to a certain extent, but we are not only that. We consist of also what we didn't do, what didn't achieve, what we didn't reach.
As I hear you talk about all that we can't know, I can almost hear a new novel precipitating out of it. I think we have about 10 minutes for questions from the audience.
So,
if anyone has one. Yes, sir.
I have a complaint, actually. John Javier, by using Muriel as a name, has made the reading of people whose primary language is English very difficult, because even though I don't move my lips when I read, and even when I'm reading it in Spanish, it's very, very hard not to read it as Muriel and think of a woman. Couldn't you have found a
different? Well, Muriel is, I'm sorry, but Muriel is a. Is a not very common, but not very uncommon surname in Spain, and I guess in Latin America as well. And well, and I was writing Spanish, and I didn't. But it doesn't matter. I mean, if you read Muriel, because that's the way you would read that name in being an English speaking person, it's not a problem, is it? I would say. I mean. What's the problem? Maybe someone could read also Madame Bovary, for instance. Well, doesn't matter, really, does it? To their minds. So your complaint, I understand it, but I think you're unfair to complain about that. No.
I admire this. I have to say, I admire the writer not trimming sails for readers in other languages, because part of our privilege as readers is to come to you rather than forcing you to come.
Yeah.
To
on us. The other hand, let me also point out to that gentleman in the first row. I think your complaint should be even refrained or even withdrawn. If you consider that there is a short chapter in the novel, rather at the beginning of it, five pages or so, in which there is a brief explanation of how things were in Spain in 1980. And I remember that one of my literary agents, when she read the novel, she said, "Do you think that's necessary? Because that's, I don't know, everyone knows that." And I said, Not the young people don't know it so well, and certainly foreign readers don't have. I mean, they're not obliged to know anything at all about Spain in general, or certainly not about Spain in 1980. So that was a concession to foreign readers.
The complaint has been withdrawn.
Thank you.
Is there someone in the second row? Yes.
Yeah.
So, in fact, what's not told is, in fact, often told.
Yes, but that's yeah, you're right, but that's, I think I would say that's a rather different thing from what I said. Of course, once you publish a novel, and in fact, I often quote couple of brief lines by Emily Dickinson, which I very much like. And she said, publication is the auction of the mind of man. And maybe that's why, or one of the reasons why she never published anything in her lifetime. She didn't want to see her mind auctioned. And auctioned, can you use it as a verb?
I think, yeah, we're in New York. I think you can use it as a verb.
Right.
It's done for many things here.
Thank you. And of course, once you publish a book, the book is not exactly the same thing as, I mean, once you're the only reader, the book is as you think it is. When there are many other readers, it may be very different. It may be subject to all kinds of understandings, interpretations, and also misunderstandings, of course. But what I mean is that the words in the novel are unchangeable. And if something is not told, of course, a reader may say, "Oh, well, but he used this adjective in this line, and maybe he was then suggesting that something which is not openly told, you know, yeah, that's legal, that's something legal to do, and that happens. But the words are the same very words. With novels, precisely, it's something that Karen Blixen, or Isaac Dinesen, who is an author I much love, said once. She said, you cannot tell a novel. You cannot tell Anna Karenina or Karenina. You cannot tell it. You have to read it in its words. Whereas a short story can be retold with different words, at least a classical short story, as we do, in fact. And I think she was right. I think that a novel is something, I mean, it's impossible to think of Don Quixote without the very beginning of Don Quixote, which is very famous, as you all know. And then Don Quixote, you cannot tell it with different words. En un lugar de la Mancha de cuyo nombre no quiero acordarme, that in Spanish is like that, you know, and you cannot say en un sitio de la Mancha, for instance, which is, would be a different word for place. And Borges talked about that. He said that, he said, for instance, once that thanks to my ignorance of Greek, for instance, of classical Greek, I can read many different versions in English or in Spanish of the Iliad or the Odyssey, whereas I'm doomed to read Don Quixote with the very same words always. He saw it as a condemnation, in a way. You could see it as a condemnation or as a... And certainly the same thing in English happens. I mean, who would say... I remember there was a translator of Hamlet into Spanish 20 years ago who wanted to be original, as it were, and then he decided the famous sentence to be or not to be, that is a question, which in Spanish has been translated in different ways, but mainly ser o no ser, esa es la cuestión. Because he said, I'm going to translate that, esa es la opción, that's the opción. And I said to him, because I knew him, and I said, but wait a minute. In English, do you have the word option? Yes. Does Shakespeare say option? No.
That was actually in the first draft. He had to be or not to be. That was the option, and he went to bed. And it was
on the other hand, to be or not to be, these are the options. You would need a plural. I think you would need a plural, wouldn't you? So it would be absurd to say no. Listen, now that sentence is going to be in English, a different one. No.
To be or not to be,
that's
the... Here are some options.
Oh, would it be thinkable to say to be or not to be, that's the dilemma? No. I mean, you're condemned, but in Spanish you could say, he ahí el dilema. Yeah, in Spanish you're allowed.
I'm happy
to
be condemned to Shakespeare.
I think I strayed away from the question.
I think we have time for maybe two more. Let's start over here. Young man over here? Yes. Mm-hmm.
Good evening.
I beg your pardon?
Roberto Colasso.
Yes. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
If you like the work of Roberto Colasso.
I have, to tell the truth, I haven't quite read it. The reasons why are too old and personal to mention him.
You can still have an opinion about it.
But he's, what I do know is that he's a great publisher. That's for sure. But I haven't read his books. It has something to do with a friend to whom he didn't behave very well. Not with me personally, but with a friend, good friend. I'm sorry, I haven't read him. I haven't read so many things. I haven't read anything by Murakami, for instance. I haven't. I don't have the time to read everything. Nobody has it. So you have to choose, and sometimes you choose just because of intuition or smell of something, or say, well, this appeals to me and this thing doesn't. And in the case of Kalasu, it has to do with this friend. I'm sorry.
I think back here, yes.
Oh, there are many, of course. I suppose the honest thing would be to say Shakespeare, also because I owe him so much, and I owe him several titles to begin with and many other things. But of course, there are always, and certainly this is not original at all, but Cervantes is one of my favorites as well, to whom, to a certain extent, by the way, I write via another of my favorite authors, whose main work I did translate into Spanish when I was in my 20s, many years ago, which is Lawrence Stern, and I did Tristram Shandy into Spanish. That's the kind of bold thing you do when you are in your 20s. And I wouldn't do it now. And of course, someone else whom I did translate also in the past, and who is certainly one of my conscious influences, is Joseph Conrad. As well, so and Flaubert is and Montaigne, and also T.S. Eliot, probably one of my favorites and also one of my strongest influences. And critics are sometimes very limited, and they never think of poets when they read a novelist as a possible influence, unless you state it, and. In my case, I know that I am much influenced by some poets, and one of them is T.S. Eliot, and he's also one of my favorite authors. So, you pick.
And I think one last one. I think back in the back there. Yeah. No, the glasses. You've been waiting very patiently.
I didn't hear you too well. Did you?
So the question was.
No, yeah, you can translate.
How you get into the minds of women characters? I think where do you get that ability from?
Well, thank you very much for thinking that happens, because I don't think that happens in my novels, and or at least it didn't happen for many. In fact, I. When I published my previous novel to Thus Bad Begins, The Infatuations, I've been using first narrators in the first person for many, many years, and that was practically the first time I used a narrator in the first person who was a woman in The Infatuations. And when it was published, somebody, of course, there are always someone reminding you of things. And they said, well, in an interview for the Paris Review a few years before that, you said that you would never do that, that that you didn't know how to do it, and that, on the other hand, it seemed too artificial to. And it's true. I had said it, and I had thought I never would for a long, long time. Because I thought, this is artificial, this is unnecessary, probably, until the day came when I didn't want to renounce to the narrator in the first person, and I knew that that story should be told by a woman, not by a man, because as told by a man, it would be impossible. It wouldn't have taken place. If I did that well, I'm glad to know. Because I was very, I felt very insecure, to tell the truth. I mean, for a good number of pages, I felt very insecure, and I thought, well, maybe the kind of jokes that my narrators usually do, maybe this young woman, rather young woman, wouldn't do them, or would she? Or you know, I wasn't absolutely sure about how to deal with that, until there was a moment in which I thought, oh, come on, we're not so different. Not in our minds, not in telling, not in observing, and probably not on reflecting. And probably a novel consists mainly of telling, observing, reflecting. And in that, we are absolutely similar, if not equal. In other things, we're not similar, of course. But then I was not dealing with those other things. I was rather dealing with telling, with what I just said.
I think that's a good note to end on. So Javier will be signing books somewhere behind this room. Thank you for making the long trip to be here. And thanks to you all for coming up.
Thank you, Garth. Thank you.